Once upon a time, there was a beautiful princess. She lived in a time when TVs were square, and if you had a Bluetooth, there was something very wrong with you. She was a fair and just princess who loved God's word, and one day she met an ogre. He really liked the princess, and she thought he was a nice ogre, so she gave him her number, her pager number. He didn't hold that against her, though. They dated for a while, fell madly in love, and were married on a beautiful autumn day. They loved being married and spent lots of time together. One of their favorite things to do was serve in the high school ministry under the leadership of a man named Pastor Mark. God created the princess with a gift called knowledge, meaning she knew and loved studying his word. So Pastor Mark asked her to help him with a special project to see what the Bible says about faithfulness. She was excited about this project and dove right in. And when she was done, she gave her research to Pastor Mark, and it was very helpful for him. Meanwhile, the ogre was committed to doing some research of his own. It was really serious work. One day after she was done with her project, the princess told the ogre they needed to talk. The ogre stepped into this conversation with great trepidation. During their talk, the princess told the ogre she felt they needed to change their method of birth control. The ogre let out a big sigh of relief and said, "Okay, to what?" "To faith," she said. "I believe we should stop relying on our plan to have kids and trust God with his plan to give us kids." To which the ogre replied, "You see, since the princess spent so much time in God's word, she learned that faithfulness is trusting God's plan even when we can't see it. She believed God had a plan for her and the ogre, but since the ogre had been so busy memorizing one-liners from sitcoms, he hadn't really learned that yet. And time passed, and the ogre was finally ready to trust God's plan for their lives. So the princess and ogre stepped out in faith together and lived happily ever after." The life isn't a fairy tale, though, is it, guys? If it were, the rest of my and Jennifer's story wouldn't have gone like this. See, what we didn't know at the time was Jennifer has a disease called endometriosis. And I'll spare you guys the anatomy lesson, don't worry. But what you need to know is it creates what doctors call a hostile environment for conception. And in our case, it was an extremely hostile environment. What we also didn't know at the time was the best treatment for her endometriosis was for her to be on the pill. And so, because of our trust in God's plan to not be on birth control, this disease completely ravaged my wife's body for over a decade. I was angry at God. You know, it's like, fine. If you don't want to give us kids, I'm cool with that, but you leave my wife out of it. I didn't care about his plan anymore. All I cared about was my plan to get her healthy as quickly as possible. And it all came to a head in September of 2011, we were sitting in a post-op appointment in the office of one of the best reproductive endocrinologists in the country. And he gave us the news, said that her case was the most impressive he's ever seen. That's bedside manner. I don't know if you know this, but that's bedside manner for the worst. After the surgery, one of her tubes was 100% blocked and the other was 98%. And that's when he delivered the death blow. He said that we would never be able to conceive children naturally. And in my mind, this is all because God's plan for us backfired. If it weren't for all this faithfulness nonsense, she'd have been on the pill and none of this would have ever happened. She'd have been healthy and fine. Did you guys see that? Did you catch that? See how quickly I changed the narrative? I spent 10 years of my life trusting his plan for us. And as soon as my circumstances get difficult, my trust went right out the window. And we're so like that, aren't we? It's easy to trust him when things are going great, but as soon as circumstances get difficult, we tend to peace out on him. And we're not alone, actually. It's been going on forever. Israel just been delivered by a pillar of fire and a parted Red Sea. Peace out on God while Moses is up on a mountain. Somebody gets a little uncomfortable with how long he's been gone. What do we do? What do we do? I got it. Give me all your jewelry. Well, the gold at least. We'll put it in a pot over a giant fire, melt it down. And then when it comes out, we'll form it into this golden calf. And we will worship it instead of the one true God who just delivered us from Pharaoh. Maybe a better example, Adam and Eve. They wanted for nothing. Literally walked in the garden with God. And as soon as they ate the forbidden fruit, their first instinct was to hide from him instead of run to him. And why do we do that? When our circumstances get rough, why do we tend to hide from him instead of run to him? You guys know the drill. We get caught up in the difficulty of life. We start telling ourselves that no one understands. No one knows what it's like. No one knows what it's like to get bullied at school. No one knows what it's like to be plagued with this addiction that I just can't kick. No one knows what it's like to go through a custody battle as the kid. No one knows what it's like to have to tell your husband that you had another miscarriage. So guys, when our circumstances get rough, it seems like he's the one who's not being faithful to us. So then how do we, when our circumstances lead us to believe that he's not being faithful, how do we remain faithful to him? And that's the question I hope we answer today. So if you've got your Bibles, would you open up to Luke chapter 22, verse 41? It's Luke 22, 41. And while you're doing that, I'm just gonna give you a little context, get you up to speed. The Last Supper is over. Jesus knows the hour of his betrayal is upon him. And so he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, and he brings a couple of disciples with him. And that's where we pick up in Luke 22, 41. It says, he withdrew about a stone's throw beyond him, knelt down and prayed, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. So here's Jesus knowing full well what's about to happen to him. His betrayal, the arrest, the physical beating, and the spiritual separation. He is about to endure one of the worst physical beatings in the history of mankind. And what's more, he's also about to endure the full and absolute wrath of God in judgment for my in your sins. Let that sink in for a minute. I'm gonna go out on a limb here and say that I think he's staring down the absolute worst circumstances in like the history of history. It's the absolute, full and absolute wrath of God. That's the ace of spades in my book. Nobody has worse circumstances. And did he peace out on God? Absolutely not. He ran to his father. That's what he always did. He ran to his father and prayed. And he prayed an honest prayer. He said, God, I love you. I want your will. And I'm not going to lie. I'm really not looking forward to this. It's going to stink. So if there's any other way, I'd really appreciate it. But I want your will, not mine, more than anything else. The text continues in verse 43. It says, an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Did you guys see how quickly his circumstances got better? Wait a minute, huh? You just said that he was in such anguish that his sweat was like drops of blood. Like that the stress of the situation was so intense that it was crushing him. He felt crushed. The muscles in his body and his forehead and his arm, they were contracting so tightly that they were bursting the capillaries in his skin, and the blood released from those was dripping through his pores. And you're right. But did you miss verse 43? An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. God did not abandon his plan on account of Jesus' circumstances, but he did meet Jesus there in the midst of those circumstances and strengthen him so Jesus could remain faithful to God's plan. Jesus knew what was coming. He knew precisely the cost. And yet he remained faithful all the way to the cross. The creator of all things so faithful that he grew and nurtured the tree that he was about to be nailed to. All because he knew that God's plan is greater than our circumstances. See, Jesus knew God had a plan, and he lived his life as though it had happened, even though it hadn't happened, because he knew it would happen. He lived his life as though it had happened, even though it hadn't, because he knew it would. And he did all this for you. Did you know that? Did you know that when he was being faithful to God's plan, that he was also being faithful to you? If you're like me, when your circumstances get rough, you tend to peace out on God a little bit and take matters into your own hands. That's probably because, like me, you tend to think that your circumstances are greater than God's plan. But the truth is, there is absolutely nothing greater than God's plan. And some of you in here are thinking, I hear what you're saying, McKibben, but you don't know. You don't know what it's like. And you're right, I don't. But he does. Don't believe the lie. Don't believe the lie that you're alone and that no one understands. Instead, rest in the truth. The truth that because of his faithfulness, we have a great high priest who can empathize with our circumstances. Stop living in isolation and run to God's throne with confidence so that he can meet you there and strengthen you just as he strengthened Jesus. Guys, God's plan is greater than our circumstances. And part of that plan was to provide us a savior, a great high priest who could empathize with us so that when our circumstances seem insurmountable, we can lean into his faithfulness and run to the Father. I found myself running to the Father shortly after that doctor's appointment. I woke up in the middle of the night and I was laying in bed and had a conversation with God. I don't know if that's ever happened to y'all. I figures that's the middle of the night, that's what I ought to do. And it got real very quickly. And I said, God, I really want to be a daddy. I want to have kids. I want to see my kids have kids. And he met me there in the midst of those circumstances and strengthened me with a peace that I can't understand. And I was able to move on from there and be okay with his plan. I said, I know that you have your best for me, and I want your will more than I want mine. We didn't know what that was. I mean, we thought it was going to be no kids. We looked at IVF and prayed through that. We prayed through adoption. We prayed through fostering. And then Palm Sunday, 2011, the princess shows back up, says, we need to talk. Okay, here we go again. I was on staff here, and it was Sunday morning. She had just gotten to church, and we met out in the lobby, and she takes me into the prayer room. It's like, oh my gosh, we're going into the prayer room. This is like a big deal. She sits me down and holds both my hands and looks at me. She assumes the posture of that we had when we were dating and we had arguments. And it's like, this is gonna be bad. I don't know what's coming. Grabs my hands, looks me in the eye and says, you're gonna be a daddy. I said, what? How? She's like, really? I'll spare you guys the anatomy lesson. Are you sure? Yeah, I took like 17 pregnancy tests. All right. Some of you know that in March, she gave birth to our third. I think we have a picture. There we go. It's my man cub on the left, Parker, my opposite gender, mini-me in the middle, and as you can tell from the flowers, my princess, Addison. on the right, all three conceived naturally. And that's cool. Don't get me wrong, it's cool. And I know you probably won't believe me, but can I just tell you what I think is cooler? It's this. It's you guys in this room. Because I firmly believe that part of the reason, part of God's plan of us going on this faithfulness journey is because he knows that someone here needs to hear that his plan is greater than your circumstances. I'm not going to pretend to know what they are, but what I'd love to do is give us an opportunity to run to the Father so we can give him those circumstances. So would you guys go ahead and bow your heads and pray with me? Jesus, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your faithfulness to the cross. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. Thank you that in you we have a great high priest who we can empathizes with us. Lord, I don't know if it's one person or 100 people in this room that need to hear this message, but I pray you would just meet them where they are right now. Strengthen them with your peace, Lord, I pray. Remind them that you have their best in store for them. Give them the strength to trust in your plan, regardless of the circumstances. I pray all this in Jesus' name.